Hi, and welcome back to the course that we're teaching right now called The Business of Building Applications. So we're talking about mobile applications and the process of design and running your business. So you can see that we are in several different units of study right now, and we're on the second one, which is called Designing an Effective App. However, there's a lot more material here, so if you would like to take a look at some of these others, make sure that you subscribe to the channel and watch along. My name is Shad Sluder, and I'm a professor of software development and computer science at Grand Canyon University. And so the course that we're working right now is called Building Apps and the Business of Design. So in this video, we're talking about the features that you would put into an early version of your app, perhaps the first version of your app. So application design includes these four topics that we're going to see in the next few videos. So we're talking about the first one right now, which is which features should you put in there? The user interface answers the question of what does your app look like? The UX, or the user experience, is how is the user experiencing the entrance, the actual flow of your app, the product delivery, and things like that. So the experience is the overall feel. And then finally, we have what's called the MVP, which is called the minimal viable product. And so getting your app to market involves making some very strategic decisions about how it looks like, how your users experience it, and how much you spend on the early development stages. So taking a look from Google, we have some advice for what users think about what makes their application valuable. So the question is, what users find most valuable about their favorite apps? And so if you're designing, make sure that you focus in on these key features. So number one on the list, they're easy to use and navigate. I suppose if you get that rule right, you've probably made almost all of the right decisions. There's always something new to explore. That's number two. And so in a future video, we're going to talk about making your apps addictive, or a nicer way of saying increasing user loyalty. And so we'll be addressing that in its own topic. And so then you can see down the rest of them, they drop off quickly. But the first one is probably the most important, getting your app easy to use and navigation. And so that's what this video and the next few are all about. So we are in this process. Let's get context of where we are. So in earlier videos, we talked about the problem that we're trying to solve, identifying a solution to a known need. Number two is finding our niche. And so looking at the competition and finding a place where we're going to succeed and the competition won't crush us. And now we're into this third one here about figuring out what user features are really important and which ones can wait till later, and balancing the user needs and the costs. And then finally, the user interface and the experience is where we're going today. So the question is, if you've got a list of nice things that your users want you to create, which ones are you going to prioritize? So you don't want to create what's called a Frankenstein app where it has every feature and nobody cares about it. You want to address what matters the most. So one way to do this is to take a look at your competition, apps that are similar to what you're trying to develop, and compare what they have. So earlier we looked in another video about the opportunity here about an app called Words with Friends, one of the biggest apps that you've probably seen in the games. And we found a surprising discovery here. If you look at the reviews, currently they're receiving mostly one-star reviews because of one single problem. They're advertising. So they're annoying their users. Even though it's a free app, people will still expect a good experience. And so if you're looking at building an app and you have a similar review problem in the App Store, take close note of that because you don't want to make sure that you do the same mistake. How about this? Is there an opportunity here? So I remember at one time it was kind of a joke to put on your resume that I'm an application designer for Craigslist, or I am a CSS expert for Craigslist. It's almost like a friend of mine who was a architect for the Aldi's grocery store. And if you know anything about Aldi's, they pretty much look like Craigslist. They're a warehouse where they just throw boxes on pallets and expect people to shop there. And so is there an opportunity here? Craigslist was so dominant. Well, there is. I have certainly used OfferUp. It's Craigslist, but with a good user interface. And you've got yourself less spam going on. You've got less corruption. You've got a great communication tool. The browsing and the video, the pictures are good. I haven't used Craigslist since. Now, here's what you want to do then. If you're looking for some kind of an opportunity like that, whether it's you're trying to kill Craigslist or Words with Friends or likely some other app that you're targeting right now, think of what you guys have in common. So your proposed app and what the competition does. That overlap we'll call analogies. And you want to check to see if the user experience is good in those areas. And if so, then don't be afraid to copy it. I mean, certainly, every time Snapchat or TikTok comes off with something cool, Instagram is not afraid to copy exactly what they see there because we don't want to lose out on what's actually working. Now, what the competition does and what you choose to leave out, we could call the anti-log, that would be the anti-analogy. And if they are doing something wrong, make sure you leave that part of it out and make your app somewhat unique. And so that way you take the best and leave what they don't want. So let me give you an example. So here is something I found on Reddit where a person was doing some research. And their research involved comparing different weather apps that are available. So you can see that this Reddit thread is Android apps. So this person is talking about designing their own weather app. And they did the research to find out who's out there and what they can do. So you can see they created a table and they have all of the different currently published apps out there. They talk about the weather providers, the number of widgets that are there, the hourly temperatures, and all the features. And so they go right through everybody's competition and come up with a pretty good chart to know what is available now. So if you were to try to get into this crowded market and build the better weather app, you'd probably want to look at this chart very carefully and see which features are working, which ones that are really important to the users, and which ones are just complete add-ons or even annoying. And so you can tell that the research here is done with quite a bit of time and effort. Also, in the typical Reddit fashion, there's all kinds of very honest reviews and feedback about people that talk about which app they use and which ones they don't like and what works. And even in some cases, you can talk directly to the developer here in one of the apps. And so do something similar to this if you are anticipating creating a list of features. So once you get yourself a little bit of competition and you make a table like this, then it's time to identify the main features of your application. Let's say you're going to build a social app. So something along the lines of Facebook or Instagram. And so you're going to put down the user stories or different tasks or different abilities that your app will feature. So for instance, one feature of your app would be to say users will create an account using current Google or Facebook password. You put it on a sticky note so that way you can move it around. Users will be able to set up a profile. That's another action that the users will do. The main part of your app, of course, is post a public message with a video or photo, or browse other people's posts and maybe comment on them, able to write things or put a like. And so this is pretty typical social media things. Now, you put these together and you start to see the number of hours of work adding up. And so it's time to prioritize which of these features are going into your app. By the way, there's nothing really unique on this app. So what do you have that is the twist? What is the unique feature or value proposition? And that should probably show up in one of your posts. So once you have most of the main features, then you want to be able to put them into categories. And so a user experience should have some kind of a cycle or process that they follow through. And as well, you should probably think about which parts of your application have good amounts of these features and which don't. So think of the first problem called activation. So which features help you activate your app? Or how do users find you? You better have a feature in there. Acquisition means how do you onboard the users? Get them from a interested party, a curious party, to somebody that's registered and somebody who is an active user. Then the retention part is what is the main point of your application? It better be interesting. It better be engaging. It better be entertaining. It better be useful. There's something there that is the main reason that people came. Now, this is the main course. And now then you get to the point where you say, I want my app to grow, so there should be some kind of a way to refer others, whether you invite them to play a game with you or to share a photo or to at least get some kind of another download from another user. And then lastly, perhaps somewhere in here, there should be a monetization. So either you ask the users to pay you money or you show them an ad or some kind of a way that you can do a cut of business. And so monetization can fit in one of these categories. So let's give an example here. So if we're talking about our social app, we would probably say our activation comes because a friend invited you to respond to a picture. And then the next step is the acquisition. So as you have to log into the account, you're invited to create your own profile. And then you're hopefully going to respond. You're going to either play the game with them, or you're going to read the post or put a comment on it. And then hopefully you share a picture and invite somebody else to look at it. And then the cycle repeats. And once again, make sure that there's some kind of a way to make a monetization play here. So show an ad. That seems to be a pretty typical thing for social media. Now, ads aren't always great, but they're pretty typical as a solution. So this is our feature map with the objectives. So let's put in here the first one, which was activation. So the users will create an account. So they're going to use Google or Facebook password. So activation, we've got that one covered. We also have they'll be able to set up a profile. So we'll put that in that column. Retention means what are we doing that creates actual value or entertainment to the people that are here. And so posting a public message with a photo or video would fit. We can also browse other people's items. And so we have an interesting activity going on. That's retention. And then we have the ability to write. Now you might be able to say, is that part of the retention, or that might fit into referral? So maybe one of those two categories would fit. Now I've got some gaps though, because I've only created two columns and I have three empty ones. So I might start to say, well, let's add some new features that I hadn't actually thought of, because we're not covering all the bases. So we have a new feature called share a picture with a friend with either a phone message or an email. And so that clearly fits in the referral category. Well, we don't have monetization and acquisition filled in yet. So what are we going to do there? Well, how are we going to monetize? Well, maybe people have a desire to promote their photo or their picture. Or if we were doing some kind of a job posting, we could promote your resume or something that people are willing to pay for other people to notice. And so we'll put that into the monetization category. Here's another one. Notify the user when your post has been liked. Oh, we all want to know that three people have seen our video. And so we'll put that into the retention area. So that's interesting. How about this? Generate a web page. So how are we going to get people to look at our images? How are we going to invite them into the app? Well, you can rely on people inviting other friends. That's one way to do it. Or in this strategy, we would create deep links. And so if somebody is posting about a picture or a subject about something that would be hit in Google searches, a place, a geography place, or an event, or a celebrity or something, then we can hopefully get a few people that are doing web searches with Google, and we pick up them through web pages. So then you've probably mapped out most of the columns by now, and you have the basic features of your application. Now, the point of this video is to try to focus on limiting your desire to fill everything. In the first stages of building an application, you want to do what's called a minimal viable product. You don't want to have the entire thing developed, because that's expensive and it's still untested. So what we're trying to avoid is a Frankenstein app. So a Frankenstein, of course, is the movie or the story of building a monster out of body parts. And this actually is a photo from experiments that were done in the 1700s of using body parts with electricity. So the danger of creating too many features is that you have created things that your users don't actually need. So let me refer you to a good blog post on the subject. So beware of feature overload, a case study. And so even though this was written some years ago, it's still very applicable today. So I wanted to capture this picture here. So live chat was this person's company communication tool. And the point of putting it on the blog was to talk about how bad the user interface was, how many features that they've tried to crowd in on one item. So look up close here. We've got ourselves every feature possible. And to the software developer, it makes total sense. They've got everything there. But for you and me that have never seen the app before, it's a little overwhelming. Where do we start? What feature is most important? And when you're trying to onboard somebody, the goal is to leave them basically one option. Just the one option that they need to do next, and hide the other features until they've become a little more proficient with the app. And so this is I don't know if you could call it a Frankenstein app, but it's certainly overwhelming. Now, if we scroll down a bit, they came up with another version of the same tool. Now, this one here is called Live Chat, and it certainly presents a whole lot fewer options. I assume all the features are still there. You can probably find them if you click the right menu, and then you're looking for those features. But if you're trying to scare away your users with overwhelming amounts of choice, then the first version is your goal. So you can see down here, the conclusion is the lesson learned. Product teams should learn to say no. And that's the point of the video that I'm telling you here, is that when you're picking your features for your first version of your application, pick only the ones that are absolutely critical and simplify your app. So let's do a summary of what we talked about so far. So that for the features that you're going to include in your app, make sure that you have them proven to be necessary. You've already done your interviews with your users, and they've told you what they think is the most critical parts of the service. And so make sure that you include those. Also, you might want to include things that are fairly easy to develop so that you don't invest a lot of time and money. And so really what you're developing then is considered the minimal viable product, or MVP. And we'll talk about that in a later video. So once you've identified the features, it's now time to create the user interface. And so if you want to look at that, the next video in the series is exactly about how you can create an effective user interface. If you want to see the entire list of course material, then take a look here at the playlist that's in the other link. So thank you for watching and welcome aboard.